Start here again. I'm not sure if the camera is because I. That's. Yeah, now I see also. So I will write here then. So let's start with an exercise. So last time we did an important example. Which is the ordered square? I ordered square. That's the ordered square. So we proved, and we will see again various other problems. Is first countable, so that's an easy exercise. First countable, but not second countable. That's, so let's make a picture. So we have the ordered square. What means first countable? First countable means in each point we have a countable family of neighborhoods such that every neighborhood contains one of these. If you want decreasing, okay? So let's take a point here, this point, x cross y. Then it's clear what it is. It's are these neighborhoods, right? And so on. So what is this? These neighborhoods are x, first coordinate, cross y minus 1 over n. So this is the interval from 2x cross y plus 1 over n. So this is an open interval, no? As usual, open interval. So these are getting smaller and smaller. So these open intervals, okay, in this point. If you take a point here, doesn't look like a square now. If you take a point here, so what do we take now? So we take as first coordinate, we can take the same, okay? So this is the point, what is it? It's x cross 1, right? That's the point x cross 1. So here we have x cross, what is it? 1 minus 1 over n. Okay, so these are these points getting closer. And on the other side, now we have to go here, okay, because it's finishing here. So we have to go here. So we take, so what is the first coordinate? What can we, so the second, the first coordinate will be x plus 1 over n times so it doesn't matter really, okay? We take we can take if you want you can take here, okay? If you want you can take here also this, right? It doesn't matter, you can take it everywhere. So let's take it here, doesn't matter. It's nicer to make a picture. So these are the points, what are the points? X plus 1 over n and what do I have to write? Well, I'm getting confused, one second. So what are the coordinates of these points? That's 1, always 1, okay? That's the second coordinate. 1 times. So we are here on this line, okay? But I might write 0 times, okay? That's also okay. So this is first countable. And then we, of course, have these points here, but here it's similar. Now we go to one, here we go down to this point, and here we go maybe on this, okay, on the other side. So it's very similar. So you get, it's first countable. It's not second, so it is first countable. It's not second countable, why not? Because all this stuff here, zero, no, x, sorry, x times 0, 1. These are these intervals, right? That's, these are open intervals. So these are open. Open. Are open. Disjoint. Non-empty, of course. These are all open, they are disjoint, they are non-empty, and they are uncountably many, okay? Uncountably many. Given a basis, each contains an element of the basis. Because it's non-empty. There's a point, then we find a basis element containing the point contained. So each of these contains an element of the basis. No? Each of these contains an element of a basis, of a given basis. So every, so no basis is countable. Okay? So every basis is uncountable. So every basis, so each basis, every basis is uncountable. So we have no countable basis. So it's not second countable. It's first countable, but not second. That's an easy exercise, okay? That's an exercise which is useful because we have the ordered square, which is one of our many examples, and we have first countable and second countable, okay? Now we make another example, which is also interesting. Then we proved last time that the ordered square is connected, but not path connected. It's very far from path connected. Its path component, there's an uncountable number of path components, okay? Uncountable number of, so it's very far from path component. So we give another example. So we take C as the graph of x times sinus 1 over x, where x, these are real numbers. X is different from 0, bigger than 0, of course, and smaller than some constant, which doesn't matter, okay? Some constant. So this is a graph of the function sinus 1 over x. How does it look like? So we have make a picture. We are in the plane. So this is a subset of the plane, okay? So it says a subspace topology. It's a subset of R2, and we have the subspace topology, okay? So how does it look like? It looks like this. It starts somewhere, and I don't care where. And then the sinus, if you go here, you go this way, okay? And now it's condensed, all this in this part. So what is happening is it goes here, and then it's, all these infinitely many start this way. So here we have one, here we have minus one, and so on and so on. So they approach this, okay? That's the graph of this sinus 1 over x, okay? So C is connected. That, no, why, well, C is path connected, no? That's easy. Path connected is easy. So C is path connected. If you have two points, you just follow the graph. So you see the path, okay, as usual. It's like the real numbers, no, more or less. C is path connected, so it's connected. Connected is not so easy, but it's connected. If it's path connected, implies it's connected. This implies that also the closure is connected. The closure of a connected set is connected. This implies that C bar is connected. Also the closure is connected. This implies, sorry. This implies also the closure is connected. The closure of a connected set is connected, okay? What is the closure of C bar? So C bar is C union. So it's clear from this picture that you have to add these points, okay? Each of these points, every neighborhood here intersects. And for other points, we find neighborhoods which do not. So the closure is C union. So what do I have to write? 0 times interval minus 1, 1. No, that's what it is. This is C, and these are all limit points, okay? All limit points. These are the limit points of C. These are the limit points of C. So this is connected. But this doesn't, so now we have this also here, right? This interval here. And this is connected, but it doesn't look path connected, of course, okay? So we suppose that we have two path components. What are the path components? This is C and this here. They are path connected, okay? But there shouldn't be a path from here to here. So how to prove that? Suppose, so I give the idea of the proof, okay? Suppose there's a path from a point here to a point here, okay? Suppose there's a path. And then we get a contradiction. Suppose there is a path from a point so this is 0 times y from a point. 0 times y in 0 times minus 1, 1 to a point, a path, f from I to C bar, no? From a point 0 times 1, so this is f of 0, no? F of 0 into to a point, well, I don't know, P in C. So we have a point here, which is this one. This is 0 times, how did I call it? 0 times y. And then we get a point here, which is P. And then we have a path from here to here. Suppose we have that, okay? There should be no path, okay? We can suppose, this is analysis, easy. We can suppose that f of t is in C if t is bigger than 0. So if t is 0, we are here in this point. After this, we are always on the other side, okay? We take all points where we are here, and then we take the sup, the least upper bound. Then we are here still. But after this, we are on the other side. Okay, so we can suppose that ft is in C for t bigger than 0. That's clear, okay? Taking the least upper bound of all points here. So f of 0 is, let me write again, f of 0 is equal to, what did I write? F of 0, where is it? Here is it. F of 0 is 0 times y, okay? This is some point here. F is continuous in 0. Now, f is continuous in the point 0, in 0, that's what we need. Now we take a small neighborhood of the image. So this is this small neighborhood. Okay? Take a small neighborhood. Consider a small neighborhood. So Z is a ball. Around 0 cross y with some radius epsilon, okay, epsilon small. This is a Euclidean, okay? Intersection with what? We are in C bar, okay? So this is open in C bar. This is a neighborhood of this in C bar, okay? This is a subspace topology, you know? So let V be a neighborhood. This is a neighborhood of 0 cross y in C bar, no? That's our space, the subspace. C bar. So this is subspace of R2, okay? Subspace. I shouldn't write here, maybe you don't see, because we are here already. Okay, we enable. So F is continuous, so there's a neighborhood U of zero, so there's a neighborhood, then there is a neighborhood. U of zero in the interval such that f of u is contained in V. That's a local definition of continuity, okay? This is an exercise for continuity, for connected, and, for, and so on and so on. F on u. We can assume that u is of the form, we can suppose that u is of the form zero delta, okay, a smaller neighborhood. We can assume that, we can assume that U is of the form, what is it? U is of the form, is an interval zero, behind the interval, no? And so epsilon I cannot take because I had already, so let's call it delta, okay? There's some small interval, no? That's the neighborhood of zero in the interval. But where's the contradiction now? So the contradiction is as follows. So this is connected. Zero delta is an interval, is connected. So we consider, sorry, we consider f from u, from this u to v, okay? Restriction. Co-restriction, restriction, okay? This is continuous. Locally, in this point. So u is connected. That's an interval. Okay? Intervals are connected. This implies f of u is connected. But what, where's f of u? What is f of u? F of u, I shouldn't go back. So it looks like this, no? So I make picture again. Here's this point. And here we are, we have all this kind of stuff, no? This kind of stuff. And here is our neighborhood, okay? But all, so in the point zero, f of zero is this point, right? But after this, we are on the other side. We are here. And this is obviously not connected, okay? Because take any other point, maybe delta over 2, okay? Then we are here on this side, okay? We are on this side, we are here. But then we can separate locally. It's clear that we can separate, no? They are connected somewhere upstairs or downstairs, no? But not here, they are not connected. This looks like this, right? F of u, but clearly f of u is not connected, okay? But clearly, so that's all, clearly, f of u is not connected. Okay, it's clear that it's not connected because you have a point here, you have a point here, and then you separate here, no? You take everything to this, everything to that, okay? And you have a separation immediately. It's not connected is easy, no? Always. It's not connected, clearly not connected. So contradiction. It's not connected, so contradiction. So this is an example. So C bar has two path components, okay? Has two path components. C. And the path components are C and 0 times minus 1, 1. These are the path components. There's two path components. It is locally connected. It is not locally connected, exactly in the points on this side, okay? It is not locally connected. C bar is, well, locally connected in C, that's okay, locally connected. It's locally connected. Now I prefer not locally connected, okay? Exactly in the points of this interval. Where's the picture of this interval, okay? So C is not locally connected. Exactly in the points of this zero times interval, okay? Zero times minus one, one. There's in these points, it is not locally connected, okay? It is not locally, that's clear that it's not locally connected, okay? Not connected is easy. And you see it's not connected, okay? So it's not locally connected in this point, so it's not locally path connected in these points also. Not locally connected implies not locally path connected, okay? Path connected implies connected, okay? It is not locally connected exactly in the points of this. And in these points, it's also not, so it's in these points, it's not locally path connected also, okay? So it is not locally path connected. In these points. Exactly in these points. Also exactly. So this is clear because path connected implies connected, okay? Path connected implies connected. So locally path connected implies locally connected, okay? So because since, so this is an exercise also. Since path connected implies connected. So this is an example, okay? This is called the topologist sine curve sometimes in the book, okay? So C bar is the topologist's, that's a classical example, of course. Topologist's sine curve. It's a graph of sine 1 over x, okay? That's a topologist sine curve. C bar or C, I don't know, C bar. For us, C bar is interesting. C is also okay, but this is, C bar is topologist sine curve. There's another strange example, because now what you can do, you make it path connected, no? How do you do that? And this has another name. So we have, again, this picture, so, okay, that's the same picture as this. And now what you do is, so this is two, it's not path connected. You have two path components, which is C and this interval, okay? There's no path from here to here. But the rest is trivial. It's path connected, okay? And now you can go this way. That's a strange example also. So I don't finish here, but I go back to this point, okay? Now it's path connected. You cannot go from here to here, okay? In this way. But you can go all the way long now, okay? So this is path connected now. Sorry. So this now is path connected. So we make it artificially. Because now it's, the connection is here, no? Not here. So now it's path connected, but it's not locally path connected, okay? Locally it's the same as before, okay? So this is path connected, but not locally path connected. So this is, one is global thing, path connected, the other is a local thing, okay? It's not the same. Path connected, but not locally path connected. So this is also a nice example. This has also a name. It's called the Warsaw Circle. It looks like a circle, a strange circle. And also, it's called the Warsaw. Warsaw is the capital of Poland. No, Warsaw, how do you write that? Circle. That's how is it called. This one. This is a topological sine curve. And if you go this, it's a circle. It looks like a very strange circle. No, you go here, and then that looks like a circle, OK? But so it's a Warsaw Circle. Warsaw is the capital of Poland, or Polish capital, OK? Warsawia. I don't know how in English. I think it's Warsaw Circle in English. In Italian, it's Warsawia, no? OK, so these are examples. Interesting examples. The topology sine curve and the Warsaw Circle. Okay? This finishes. Well, the example always takes a lot of time. So this finishes the second chapter for the moment. We come back to the, I continue here now. We come back to the ordered square. We will see it again. It doesn't disappear. We have other properties, because now we talk about compact spaces. So we go back to basic stuff. So this is the third chapter. The third chapter, which are compact spaces. Three, which is called compact spaces. So we go back to basic definitions. That's the third one. Second one, connected. And here we have even more possibilities to define compactness. I mean, compactness, compact. That's, but then there's limit point compact, there's sequentially compact, there's countably compact, there's this compact and that compact. Okay, so there are many, much more. Connected and path connected. Okay, here we have more notions. So a covering, so basic definitions, an open covering. So we are interested in open covering. An open covering of a space, X, of a topological space, of course, X, is a family, is a collection family, the same, a set of, is a collection, I think in the book then he has collection, I wrote collection here, or family, U, well, U alpha, alpha in some index set of open sets, so it's an open covering of open sets in X whose union is X, That's an open covering whose union is X. So this is a definition, if you want. An open covering is a of a topological space is a collection of open sets, a collection, a family, a set of open sets, in X whose union is X. X is connected, compact. X is compact if every open covering of X has, and now this is very convenient way to talk. It's not used in the book, but it's very convenient. If every open covering of X has a finite subcovering, it's not so clear what is a subcovering in general. There are various possibilities to define. Has a finite subcovering. So this means U alpha 1, U alpha n, no? As a finite subcovering, U alpha 1, U alpha n, whose union is X, again, okay? Whose union is X. Oh. Subcovering, whose union is X. This is sort of a strange definition, no? If you want to define compactness, nobody comes with this definition. You never heard that. That's clear. You have maybe closed and bounded, if you are an RN or something like that. No, closed, bounded, but not this, this seems strange definition, okay? Compactness. Still, it's a basic definition of compactness because it's very easy, no? One line. It's not technical. Bounded and closed is also easy, of course, but that's in Rn, okay? So it's a metric. We need a metric for bounded. So this is a definition. And there's immediately a small lemma, which is an exercise, or not even exercise. It's trivial, but it's useful. So I will write this lemma, which says, let me see. And then we discuss examples, some examples. So let y be a subspace of x. Let y in x be a subspace, a subset, a subspace. That means with a subspace topology, no? Let y in x be a subspace, then y is compact. This is also a way of talking, very useful. Then y is compact. Or topology, the subspace topology, okay? Of course, in the subspace topology. Then y is compact in the subspace topology, if and only if so I abbreviate, okay? If and only if every open covering of y, every open covering of y has a finite subcovering means compact. That's the definition. But now I take every open covering of y in x. So this makes a difference. Open, so this is an open covering of y, but in, so I have to do this. That means by open sets in x, that means it's a way of talking also, useful. By open sets in x, not in y, by open sets in x, whose union contains y, not equal to y. If it's equal to y would be open. Maybe y is not open, okay? Compact, maybe it's not open. So that means by open sets in x, whose union, every open covering, by open sets, whose union contains y. That's whose union. Contains y. Not equal. Okay. That means open covering of y in x. So I will not write the proof. I write in Italian. Proof. I will not write the proof. Demonstration. Yeah, thank you. I was explaining the notion and forgot to say. Every open covering of y in x, by open sets in y, contains a finite subcovering. Thanks. So finitely many suffice, and their union contains y, not equal to y, contains again, okay? So the proof, demonstration, which I will not write the proof, pass from open sets to x, so it's very trivial, pass from open sets in x, so it's if and only if, to open sets in y, by taking intersections, and vice versa, okay? in Y by taking intersections. So it's very boring proof, intersections. But it's useful. By taking intersections and vice versa. So if something is open in Y, then there's something open in X. Intersecting this Y, we get exactly the open sets in Y, okay? So we can pass from open sets in Y, and then this is clear, this if and only if, okay? So I will not write, that's boring. Now, very often it's more convenient to work with open sets in X, that's the reason, okay? We can describe. Y may be complicated, so we don't know, but X, we can describe open sets. If you have a basis, basis elements, in general, can be easily described, okay? Basis elements. So examples, and again, we have this same kind of philosophy as for connected. It is very easy to prove that something is in exercises. It is easy to prove that something is not compact, okay? Because you just have to find one open covering which does not have a finite subcovering. For example, the reals are not compact. And it's clear the open covering, you take intervals, minus n, n, and you make it bigger and bigger, and you have no finite subcovering, okay? So the reals are not compact, that's trivial. It's easy to prove not compact, but it's not useful, okay? It is difficult, it may be difficult, to prove something is compact, but this is useful. So examples, not compact. If you take 1 over n, n in n, so this is a subspace of R, it's not compact. It's not compact. Well, in analysis you say it's not closed, right? But that's not our definition. We have nothing closed here, okay? We just have open coverings and so on. So it's not compact. What is it? There's a subspace of the standard reals, okay? Subspace of standard reals. What is the topology of this? Question for you. What is the topology? This has a name. If you take this subspace of the reals, what is this topology? So this is Y, no? And R is X. That's our space. Yeah, it's discrete. Y is a discrete space, okay? Has a discrete topology. Y has a discrete topology. A discrete space, when is a discrete space compact? Yes, exactly, it's fine. Because points are open, so we take points as open sets. Finite subcovering means we have only finitely many points, okay? Yeah, right. Has a discrete topology. This is not compact, okay? And from analysis, of course, clear, no, you have to take the closure, no? So it takes the closure. Why closure? This is 1 over n. This is Y union 0. Is compact. Now, this is compact. And now you say, well, this is analysis. It's closed and bounded, but that's not our definition. No? There's no closed, no bounded, nothing like this. We have open covering and finite subcoverings, okay? So it seems, so it's compact. So what we do, so we prove it. So we use a definition, okay? So let U be a finite, let U be a, so proof. Let U is compact, so I prove this, okay? Let U be a, an open covering. Of, so it's a closure here. Why a closure? And I work in the reals. I take open sets in the reals, okay? Open covering of Y in R. And the crucial point, of course, is the point zero, okay? So then zero is in some element. Zero is in U zero, which is in U, okay? So it's, it covers, okay? So it's somewhere. Oh, this is open. where is it open in the reals, all right? Open in the reals. We have an open covering in the reals. So this means, of course, so this means that zero is in some interval, no? This is open, so minus epsilon epsilon contained in U0. We have the standard topology on the reals. So we find epsilon, so that it's here. So now let 1 over n, okay, 1 over n. So choose n zero, choose n such that 1 over n is smaller than epsilon, okay? Sorry, n in the natural numbers, of course. Then 1 over n is in U0 for n bigger equal to n0. N. Okay? Because it's here. And for the other ones, choose, let. So what is missing? Maybe it's missing 1 over 1 be in U1, 1 over 2 be in U2. So how many we need? N minus 1, okay? 1 over n we have already, no? So the last one, which maybe is missing, is is 1 over n minus 1, no? Right? 1 over n we have already. So this is in u n minus 1. Choose these, okay? Then we have a finite subcovering. Then U0, which contains almost all already, okay? And then for the other ones, we take finitely many, and so U1, UN minus 1 is a finite subcovering. Point. So this is the proof, okay, with our definition. It's compact. So this implies Y bar, how is it called? Y bar is compact. Well, it should be compact, no? You, in analysis, you say it's bounded and closed, okay? And with our definition, it's also compact. Now, this is a standard example. Now I give a non-standard example. There's always the standard from analysis, and then there are these strange examples, but interesting examples from general topology, like the RL, the lower limit, like the ordered square, like R omega, okay, infinite products with box, with product topology, and so on. So another example. We take an infinite set, let X, no, not a set, be a set with the finite complement topology. That's another example, not which, or every now and then, with the finite complement topology. So we take a set and we take the finite complement topology, okay? Then every subset of X is compact. That's sort of strange. Then every subset of X is compact. Every subset of X is compact. Every subset of X is compact. Maybe something is wrong here with the definition. But what are the closed subsets? The closed subsets What are the closed subsets? Finite and the whole. Okay? But the closed subsets. Are finite or X or X, okay? The whole is. But the closed subsets are finite or all X? So the whole X or X. I don't know. Okay. So if X is infinite, they're much more compact subsets than closed subsets, okay? So if X is infinite, if X is infinite, there are many subsets, each infinite subset is compact but not closed. Okay, each infinite subset of course different from X, okay, we exclude the whole now, each infinite subset different from X is compact, everything is compact. But not closed. Finite subsets are closed, and the whole, but not closed. So compact does not imply closed with our definition. So does not imply closed in general. So maybe the definition is not good, but well, with this definition, no? We will need another condition, which is Hausdorff, okay? We will add Hausdorff. Then it's okay. We need Hausdorff. So, proof. The proof is the same as before. So, let U be an open covering. Sorry, let X be sub, then every subset Y of X, let me edit here, okay? Every subset Y of X is compact. So let U be an open sub, a covering of Y in X. Choose Y zero in Y. All right, Y is non-empty. If it's every empty set is compact, okay? An empty set is compact. Well, I don't know if that makes sense. Empty subset. So we can assume that it's not empty, okay? The empty subset anyway. If you want to admit it, then it's compact. So then we have the same proof, that Y0 be in, how is it called? U0 in U. So it's somewhere, okay? But U0 has finite complement. So this is open in X. This is open in X. So oh, what? I want to finish here. Let be an open covering of Y and X. So U0 is, has finite complement. So U0 intersection. It has finite complement. Yes, thanks. I'm getting y minus, these are the points which we don't have, okay? We have everything in U0. Y minus U0 is finite, okay? Well, U0 is maybe not in Y, okay? So minus intersection Y, if you want, okay? Well, it's finite. So this is equal to Y1, Yn. It's finite. Okay, finitely many points. So then we have the same proof. Let Y1 be in U1, Y2 be in U2, and so on. How many we need? N. Now it's N, no? This is missing. N minus 1 here, but it doesn't matter. UN be in YN. Be in UN, okay? And then we have the same U0, U1, and now we have UN. It's a finite subcovering. So that's it. It is, every subset is compact. But maybe we want compact sets to be closed, okay? With this definition, it's not closed. But it's not a problem because now we have, I continue here now. So there's easy properties now. Some first, a little lemma, which is very easy. Every closed subset of a compact space is compact. That's every closed subset of a compact space. Topological space, of course, of a compact space. Every closed subset, I may even give norm immediately, Y, of a compact space X is compact. So this is proof. This is almost trivial. So what every closed subset Y, so let U be an open, always the same, let U be an open covering of Y in X, okay? Let U be an open covering. We use our definition of Y in X, with open sets in X, okay? Then we just have to add one. Then U union, which one? We take the complement of Y, X minus Y. So Y is closed. So this is open. This is an open covering of X now. It's an open covering of X. That's an open covering. My X is compact. So there's a finite subcovering, okay? So there's a finite subcovering. For U union X minus Y first, no, because X is compact. And then also for U. And then also for U. This we don't need for Y. And then also for U. So we take just these. For U. No, not U. How is it called? Y. Point. So this is easy. So closed subsets of compact is compact. Compact is not closed, unfortunately. But, so is a proposition. Proposition says, if you are in a Hausdorff space, then it's okay. So every, says, every compact subset of a Hausdorff space is closed, okay? Every compact subset So I give name, Y. Every compact subset Y of a Hausdorff space So we need, here's Hausdorff's important. Hausdorff space X is closed. So if a Hausdorff space, then compact sets are closed. So in many, in various books, in some books, in half of the books, compact is our definition plus Hausdorff. Okay? And our condition then is called quasi-compact or something like that. Okay? But in the book Mancres, compact does not include Hausdorff. So if you want this, then we have to say a compact Hausdorff space. And in some books, compact includes Hausdorff, okay? One has to look in the book what is compact, okay? Our definition, the definition of Mancres or including Hausdorff. So proof of this. Let's prove this. I mean, the finite complement topology of on an infinite set is not Hausdorff, no? That's a crucial point. It's not Hausdorff. That's we saw some weeks ago, okay? The finite complement topology, if it's infinite, it's not a Hausdorff space. It's T1, but not T2. That was an example, okay? It's not a Hausdorff space. That's a point. Okay, proof. So we choose a point in x minus y. So we have to prove, we will prove x minus y is open, okay? So let x0 choose a point x0 in x minus y. We will prove, we want to find a neighborhood of x0, which is contained here. And then x minus y is open. So we make a picture. Well, this is y. And here's a point x0, which is not here. So for each y, now take any point here, y, small y in capital Y. For each small y in y, there are disjoint neighborhoods. So it's Hausdorff. We have two different points now. So it's Hausdorff. So there are disjoint neighborhoods. Of y and x0. So what uy. Uy. So x0 is fixed, okay? And now y. x0 is fixed anyway. So in the same neighborhood, uy of x0 and vy also of y. So we have here all these short neighborhoods. This is uy. X0 is fixed, so we don't need it. And here's a disjoint neighborhood, which is Vy. And they are disjoint. Then we have an open covering of Y in X. So then you, these are the Vy. Vy, Y in Y, is an open covering. Of y, we have all points, but in x. So it's very convenient, this way to talk, okay? Open covering, so these are open sets in x, not in y, okay? So it's very convenient. It's an open covering of y in x. But y is compact. What does it mean? We have a finite subcovering. So there's a finite subcovering. There is a finite subcovering how is it? V y n for some natural number n, no? There's a finite subcovering. What do we want to prove? We want to find the neighborhood of what is the neighborhood? It takes intersection of the U's. Then UY1, so we have V and U. Intersection. We have to take finitely, we want finitely many. Yeah? UYN. That's the neighborhood of x0. It's the neighborhood of x0, finite intersection. Disjoint from y. Contained in x minus 1. Contained in x minus 1. And this then means, of course, that x minus y is open. And this means that y is closed. So this is the proof. This is more interesting. No? The Hausdorff property is important. The first important property of a topological space is the Hausdorff property, okay? So we prove some other small things. The main theorems we prove tomorrow for compact spaces, okay? Today, these are smaller, easy stuff. Definitions and some lemma. So here's the next lemma. A proposition. Proposition. If f from y, x to y is continuous, and x is compact, then f of x is compact. So this means the image under a continuous mapping of a compact set is compact. The image of a compact space, of a compact set, is compact. Of course, under a continuous mapping. Okay, that's clear. Everything is continuous here. Under a continuous mapping. Under a continuous map. That's the same as connected, no? The image of connected set is connected. The image of a path-connected set is path-connected. That's easy, very easy exercise. The image of a connected set is connected. The image of a path-connected space is path-connected. The image of a compact space is compact, and so on. A proof. This is very easy, all this stuff. It's very easy. So what if let U be an open covering of, this definition is very convenient of compactness, no? The proofs are all easy. They're not technical. We just use the definition. Let U be an open covering of f of x in y. So it's very convenient also to have open sets in the whole, okay? So let u be an open covering of f of x in y. Then the pre-image, f minus 1 of u. So what is that? That's, of course, f minus 1 of u, u in u. Well, this is u written, and this is u printed, okay? It's an open covering of what? Of x. But x is compact. X is compact. So there's a finite subcovering. What is it? F minus 1 of u1, f minus 1 of un. Finitely many, so far. And then u1, un is a finite subcovering of u, okay? Finite subcovering. This is of f minus 1 of u, no? Of this one? Then u1, un. It's a finite subcovering. Of u. It's not clear immediately. So each point in X is in one of these. Who are you asking? Yeah. Of U of Y. Of X. What is the question? Sorry, I didn't understand the question. It's of both. In some sense, it's of both, no? You have a finite subcovering of the space, and you have a finite subcovering of the covering of the space, no? So there's, yeah, okay? A finite subcovering of U. Here we have of Y, okay? Here we are in Y. And here, of f of x, here we are in x, of x. So they are two times off, no? Okay. This is a space, and this is a covering, okay? So we have a finite subcovering of the space or of the covering, or of both. Okay, yes. So then it's a, so now it calls a theorem. It's also easy, but the first theorem. It's a theorem in the book. Let's see. Let F, yes, let F let f from x to y be continuous. And bijective. If X is compact, then F is a homeomorphism, okay? If X is compact, then, no, I need something else. If X is compact and Y is Hausdorff, we will see the proof, okay? And Y is Hausdorff. So we need X compact, Y is Hausdorff, then F is a homeomorphism. That means also that is, i.e., also F minus 1 from Y to X is continuous. That we have to prove, no? That's in general not true, okay? But under this hypothesis, X is compact and Y is Hausdorff, then also the inverse map. This is the inverse map, okay? Then also the inverse map, well, I mean, is continuous, okay? That we have to prove. That's not true in general. So proof. We have to prove that F minus 1 is continuous, no? That we have to prove. F minus 1 is continuous. So F minus 1 from Y to X is continuous. That we want to prove, if and only if. Pre-image of open sets are open, okay? F minus 1 minus 1. Pre-images. What is this pre-image? F minus 1 pre-image of U of open sets in X are open. Okay. What is this? That's U. F is bijective, okay? And I don't want to work with open sets. But I don't want to work with closed sets. Because it's compact, we have compact, okay? So let me write, that's also continuous, no? Closed. Pre-images of closed sets in X are closed in Y. Continuous means pre-image of open sets are open is equivalent to pre-image of closed sets. It's the same. It's equivalent, okay? We can work with open sets or with closed sets. This means images under F minus 1.
Professor, F minus 1 minus 1 is equal to F, not identity. F minus 1 minus 1 equal to F, non-identity function, Fu.
Thank you. Yes. So I would have noticed now, because I write, that means that under F, images of closed sets are closed. So this means F is a closed map, okay? So this means F is a closed map. What means closed map? Yes, yes, F of U, of course. F is a closed map. That means images of closed sets are closed. Images of closed sets are closed. So this we can prove. F is a closed map. That we want to prove, okay? So let A be closed in F is a closed map. F goes from where to where? So X is, so let A be closed in X, no? A be closed in X. So what is X? X is compact. Closed in compact is compact. Now then F, this implies F, A is compact. A closed subset of a compact space is compact. Okay? Always. A closed subset of a compact space is always compact. Here we don't need Hausdorff. We don't need it. That's maybe the first lemma on the left side, trivial lemma, okay? The first thing on the left side. Closed in compact is compact, always. We don't need Hausdorff. F is compact. Now, F of A is compact. The image of a compact set is compact, okay? Under continuous mapping, the image of a compact set is compact. Or compact space, set, subset, whatever. Compact set is compact. FA is compact. So FA is closed. So I don't know where to write. I write here. So this implies that F of A is compact. Now what do we want? It's closed. Why? A compact subset of a Hausdorff space is closed. Yeah. Now here we need Hausdorff, no? Wherever it is, here, Hausdorff. A compact subset of a Hausdorff space is closed. So F is closed. The map F is closed. And that means F minus 1 is open, is continuous. OK, so this is the theorem. These are all very easy, general stuff. You use only the definition of compact, OK? Hausdorff. Compact definitions, very easy. So the first theorem, another theorem where we have to work a little bit, but not too much. The main theorems come tomorrow for compact spaces. So I will continue here now. For theorem, if X and Y are compact, a product. Sorry, the product X cross Y of compact spaces X and Y is compact. product x cross y of compact space is x, y is compact. X and y is compact. Okay, so this implies finite products of compact spaces are compact. These are two spaces. Okay, any finite product of compact spaces is compact by induction. Any finite product of compact spaces. It's compact. We'll prove it for two, and then we have finitely many. There's a famous Tychonoff theorem, okay? It is true for arbitrary products. So theorem, that we, I prove this. But there, it's true also for arbitrary products. So theorem. That's one of the two, three most famous theorems of general topology. So theorem. But this I will not prove. It's proved in the book, but not in this chapter. It's proved later. It's a longer proof. And this is the famous Tychonoff. 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 Whatever. An arbitrary product of compact spaces is compact. Here we have two. Finite, okay. But it's true for arbitrary. Arbitrary product. Of compact spaces. It's compact. That's a famous Tychonoff. And here I have to add, in the product topology, okay? In the product topology. In general, not in the box topology. Not true for the box topology in general, okay? So we will see an example. Not true for the box topology. For finite product, there's no difference, okay? It's the same topology. We have three. We have product, uniform, and box. For infinite products, for arbitrary products, they are different in general in the product topology. Not true for the box topology. In general, it might be true, but in general, it's not true. So we will see an example. Not now. So we prove this only, okay, here. So proof. So we need a lemma, which is, so I will, that's a name, because there are various exercises associated to this name, which I will give tomorrow, okay? This is a tube lemma. Tube lemma. Tube lemma. So this is, has a name, the tube lemma. So consider the product x times y, where y is compact. So we use, I use the notion of this theorem, okay, x, y. We don't need x is compact for the moment, only y is compact, okay? So consider the product x plus y like this, where y is compact. If n is an open set, if n is open in x cross y and contains, it's a neighborhood, that would be here, and contains a slice, the slice So they call it a slice. X0 cross Y. That's just a name, slice. X0 cross Y. If n is, so n is the neighborhood of X0 cross Y, okay? N is the neighborhood. Of X0 cross Y. That's the same. Then there is a neighborhood W, then there is a neighborhood W of X0 in X, obviously, such that W times Y is contained in N. And this is called a tube. That's why tube lemma. Tube. And this he calls slice in the book, and this is a tube. So let me make a picture. So here's a picture. So we have X cross Y. So proof. No, not proof. Picture. So we have X and we have Y, X cross Y. So we have a point X0 here and we have, this is a slice. Oh, this is a slice, X0 cross. And what we have a neighborhood, N. So N is this. So this is N. And then we have a neighborhood W here. This is X0. No. We have W here, a neighborhood of this, such that the product here, well, the tube W times Y is contained in N. Okay, like this picture. So this is a picture where you see everything. That's a tube lemma. It's not true if Y is not compact. Because if Y is not compact, you can come with this arbitrarily close to this here, okay? Here you don't come arbitrarily close. So it's easy to give examples. It's not true if Y is not compact. So the last thing I will prove this, okay? So proof. So there are at least two exercises which use the tube lemma, which I give tomorrow, okay? In the book, of the book, proof. So we have N, the neighborhood. We cover X0 cross Y by open sets of the form, U cross V. So we take any point here, okay? Any point here on this, and then we have N is open, contained in N, okay? N is open, so we have bases are products of open sets, okay? So for each point here, we find an open set, a product, which is contained in N. So of the form contained in N, contained in N is open. So we take, for each point here, we take such a product, right? For each point. That's the definition of the topology. Product topology of the form contained in it. But X0 cross Y is compact. But x0 cross y. This is homeomorphic to y. As a subspace, it's not the same, okay? This is y. This is a subspace of x cross y, okay? But they are homeomorphic. You forget this point. That's a homeomorphism, okay? Homeomorphism. Homeomorphic. So it's compact by hypothesis. So this is compact. So we have an open covering of x0 cross y in x cross y, okay? So, but it's compact. So this implies finitely many. Of these products, finitely many U1 cross V1, UN cross VN of these products, we need only finitely many of these products cover X0 cross Y. We need only finitely many because it's compact. We can suppose by the, yeah, okay. Then what is W? If we need W, no? What is W? So W, let W be, yes, U1 intersection UN, no? We take the intersection of these parts here, okay? So if we here we have these finitely many, no? And so on. Finitely many, okay? And we intersect over these parts here, okay? So let W, U1, UN, then that's okay. Then this works. Then W times Y is contained in N. Because all these are contained in N, okay? All these are contained in N. Finitely many of the product cover X. So these are all contained in N. That's the point, okay? They are contained in N. And then this is contained in N. And that's a proof. So this is a tube lemma. And what we will prove tomorrow is the first theorem, but not the second. The second would be nice, but we don't have time for that, okay? Because today we have lecture number, it's set even, no? 7, right. And tomorrow is 8, okay? And next we have 9 and 10. So we don't have time for Tichonov to prove. It's a nice proof, but there are various proofs of Tichonov. There, in the book, the proof is long. That would take, anyway, long time. Then there's another proof which uses sequences are not enough for compactness. That we will see tomorrow, okay? And then sequence is not good, then one can define other stuff, like filter. That's the generalization of sequence. And then there's a proof you use instead of sequences. Sequences are, tomorrow we'll see that sequences are not enough to characterize compactness, okay? We cannot use sequences, but we can use filters. That's a generalization of filter. The point is that sequences are countable. If a space is not first countable, then sequences are not sufficient, okay? If it's not first countable, then sequences are not good enough. And there are compact spaces which are not first countable, okay? So sequences are not enough, then one has filters, and filters are a generalization of sequences, but without countability, okay? We don't have countable, and then it's okay. And then there's a proof of Tichonov, which is a very nice proof, which uses filters instead of sequences. Sequences one cannot use, but instead of sequences uses filters. And that's a very conceptual proof, okay, of Tichonov. Nice proof. But then first one has to develop the, not theory, but definition, what is a sequence? What is a filter? Sorry. Then one has to develop filters, okay, first. And that takes a little bit of time. And it works with ultra filters even, so we use something like not axiom of choice, but Zorn's lemma and stuff, ultra filter. And then the proof of Tichonov gets very conceptual, okay? Nice proof, we will not see that. Even filters are not in this book of Mankiewicz. You don't find the definition of filter in the book, okay? He doesn't use that. So he gives a direct proof of Tichonov. But this direct proof is, one has to work, okay? One has to work. We have to work for the first a little bit, okay? We use the sequence lemma tomorrow to prove that. That's easy now, okay? But one has to work a little bit. For the Tichonov, one has to work much more. So we don't prove it. So we prove the main theorem, other main theorems, Heine-Borel and whatever, and then type of Bolzano-Weierstrass. Now, these are the theorem from analysis, Bolzano-Weierstrass property and Heine-Borel, and this, and we prove some main theorems for compact spaces tomorrow. And as usual, we concentrate on, we have the standard examples from analysis, and then we have the non-standard examples from general topology. And we will see immediately again the ordered square, which is compact. The ordered square is also compact, okay? So that's also, we will see that, why is that, and so on. That's a non-standard example. So we see, we can go on tomorrow at 4, no? Okay, so questions or remarks? Then I will close now this one.